This is question 3. Now, what we've got here is a Tasmania Jones question. So we know that Tasmania Jones is in Switzerland in this adventure. He is working in as a construction engineer, and he is developing a thrilling train ride in the mountains. He chooses a region of the mountain landscape, the cross-section of which is shown in the diagram below. Looks very mathematical. Funny about that. So the cross-section of the mountain and the valley shown in the diagram, including a lake bed, which looks like this thing here, is modelled by the function with this rule here. Okay. Tasmania knows that A, which is this point here, is the highest point on the mountain, and that C, now where's that? C here, 2 and 0, and B, 4 and 0, are the points at the edge of the lake, situated in the valley. Okay, I think we've got all that, don't you? All right, now let's go with it. All distances are measured in kilometres, and the first thing we have to do is find the coordinates of G, the deepest point in the lake. Well, come on, now you have a think about this. How would we do this, guys? Well, I think there's a derivative going to be happening here and setting it equal to zero. So we'll take this thing here, this cubic thingy, and why don't we do the derivative of it and set it equal to zero, and probably we'll get two values, I would think, here and here, this being the maximum, this being the minimum, and then we'll just make up our minds which one's appropriate. It'll be somewhere between 2 and 4, the x-coordinate of the minimum. So let's see how we go with that. That's a classic case for CAS. You just go with it, plug and chug. So we solve for df dx equals 0. Oh, there it is. Look at that. So, okay, so I put this in as f1 of x in my trusty CAS handheld device, and I got a yes, Roger Dodger, that one, from the calculator, and then I solved for the derivative, okay, d by dx of f1 of x equals 0 for x. Just as I suspected, I got a 0, that's the max over here, which I don't want, and this is the min, which is the one I do want. So that looks like the x-coordinate of the deepest point in the lake, doesn't it, guys? Now, what are we going to do? What are we going to find? The coordinates of g. Okay, so we need to plug this value of x into this cubic here to find the y-coordinate, which is what I've done here. f1 of 28 over 9 gets me this, so therefore I can quote my answer. That was worth, goodness, that was worth, don't tell me, was that worth three marks? Goodness gracious, that's marvellous. It's three very easy marks. There's my answer. And put a box around it. Thank you, Mr. Box, so the examiner knows where your answer is. Well, we're off to a great start, aren't we? Alrighty, next bit. Now, Tasmania's train ride is made by constructing a straight railway line AB from the top of the mountain A to the edge of the lake at B. The section of the railway line from A to D passes through a tunnel in the mountain. Okay? Write an equation of the line that passes through A and B. Well, we need our diagram. There it is. Now, let's have a look at that. There it is. Now, let's just size it up, guys. This is A, as we discovered earlier. This is D. So this little bit here must be the tunnel. Okay? That's the tunnel going through the mountain. It comes out the other end into daylight again at D. Now, what are we going to do? Get this equation of the line. This is worth two marks. Always look at this before you do anything. So we need a bit of working and an answer for that. So it's just the equation of a straight line, isn't it? Well, that's pretty easy. Goodness. We got a y-intercept here of a half. And all we've got to do is really work out the gradient. Then do the old y equals mx plus c trick, don't we? I think so. So, oh, there it is. Ma to b is, now, what have I got there? Oh, yes, so it's basically the rise is a half. Okay, this bit here, that's a half. The run is 4, and it's a negative gradient because it's going downhill, right? Downhill as you move from left to right across the page. The same way that you read a book, if it's going down, then the gradient is negative, okay? So our gradient is minus 1/8, looks like. Okay, and we know that our y-intercept is a half, so therefore we've got it. My goodness me. Y equals minus 1/8 of x plus a half. That deserves a box. Thank you, Mr. Box. And we've got our two marks. How marvellous. Let's keep going. Over the screen we go. Okay, now what have we got to do? Show that the x-coordinate of D, the end point of the tunnel, is 2/3. Okay, what are we going to do here? It's 2/3. Well, I think that means a simultaneous equation solved, don't you? If we solve the simultaneously the straight line equation with this cubic-y thing, we should get the places where the intersections are. Now, I think we're probably going to get three answers. There'd be A, there'd be D, and there would also be B down here, wouldn't there? And we can easily work out which one D is going to be. So let's solve these simultaneously, and that's a perfect example of where you would use CAS to great effect. And there it is, guys. My goodness, what have we got? Okay, so you've got this thing. I've made that F2 of X, and got the Roger Dodger from the calculator over here. Then I said solve F1 of X. Now, F1 of X was the cubic thingy, equals F2 of X for X. Well, just as we thought, guys, look, naught, which is the top of the mountain bit here, and 2/3, oh, marvellous. See, that's what we have to show it is the x-coordinate is equal to, yeah? So we've done that. And also x is 4 over here, which is what we thought we were going to get. So I think that's satisfactory. How many marks was that? It's only a one-mark question. But it's a show that, so you still got to show. You get that? Like for one-mark questions, usually you just have to give the answer, but if it's a show that, you've actually got to show it. So this would be a satisfactory way of showing it. You'd say you solve them simultaneously, you'd say what the answers are, and you would reject the naught and the 4 for the appropriate reasons. The naught is at the top of the mountain, the 4 is at the right-hand edge of the lake at B, and therefore x is 2/3. I haven't actually written that little memorandum down there as to why we're rejecting the naught and the 4, but you would need to do that, so please do that in an exam setting. And thank you, Mr. Box. We're going absolutely fantastically, aren't we, guys? So, find the length of the tunnel AD. Now, what's that again? Oh, yeah, no problem, guys. The length of the tunnel, that's just the distance between two points. So this is naught and a half. This one here is 2/3, but we don't have the y-coordinate, do we? Oh, but we can easily find it out. Once we do that, it's just the distance between two points using Pythagoras' theorem. So we've got the equation of the straight line there. Let's plug in x as 2/3 and see what we get for y. Just plug and chug, and what do we get there? It looks like we get 5/12. Yeah, great. So now we can work out using the formula, the Pythagorean formula for the distance between two points, a.k.a. A and D, and there she be. Yes, you know how to do that, don't you? That's from year 10. Come on, brush up. If you can't remember, you've got to be able to know. You've got to know that, yeah? So what does that come out to be? Root 65 over 12. So that is the length of the tunnel. Mr. Box, thank you again. Okay, now you could do that very easily and to great effect with CAS, which is what I would recommend you do. But just be careful with the keystroking. Make sure you type in everything incorrectly. And you will triumph. Yes? All right. What else we got here? Goodness, this is getting to be bigger than Ben-Hur, this thing. In order to ensure that the section of the railway line from D to B remains stable, D to B, right? Got it? Remains stable. Tasmania constructs vertical columns from the lake bed to the railway line. Goodness. excuse me. The column E to F, that's this one here, is the longest of all possible columns. Refer to the diagram. Yes, we've got the diagram. Find the x-coordinate of E. I think we need an expression for the length of the vertical column. Okay, and that is going to be the height of this point minus the height of this point. They're the y-coordinates. y2 minus y1 gets you a vertical length. But of course, those y's can be expressed in terms of x by means of the rule for the straight line and for the cubic, all right? So therefore, when you've got the expression for that height, then you can do the old calculus trick and get the derivative of it and then set that equal to zero to get a stationary point which either denotes a maximum or a minimum. Now, before I get too carried away, let's do that. So we're saying that EF is the height, which is the straight line, which is the upper y value, okay, minus the F point here, which is the cubic Y value expressed in terms of X. Yes, looks a bit demented, doesn't it? Oh, well, don't worry. We've got CAS to help us, guys. Now, we have to say for the maximum EF vertical height, we need the derivative of that height with respect to X is equal to zero, okay? Oh, here comes the CAS. Beautiful. So what I've done there is I've said solve for the derivative of one minus the other, okay? One of them minus the other. Actually, that looks like the cubic minus the straight line around the other way. But it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter which order you do it. The derivative of one minus the other, set it equal to zero, you'll still get a stationary point for x, yeah? And look at this. Good heavens above. So x is this, or it's equal to this. Now, oh yeah, I'm just getting an approximate answer. I just basically went Control-Enter to get from all this absurd stuff down to something that I can actually read. What is it? What does it say? It says 0.318275, which is perfectly... Oh, I just realised what that is. How marvellous. I'll reveal all in a second. Or 2.79284. Now, this is the one we want, obviously, because this is the one they're talking about, somewhere between an x-coordinate of 2 and an x-coordinate of 4. So that's going to be the max, guys. That's going to be a max. And this over here is the other stationary point, which is up here, because that's less than 2/3, and it's between 0 and 2/3 in terms of x-coordinates. That must be the min. And this is a little teensy-weensy little height, isn't it? Isn't that marvellous? So we've got ourselves the min and the max, and of course we want the max. So find the x-coordinate of E. So it looks like it's this little beastie here, isn't it? I think so. Yeah, that's the max. There it is. That is the x-coordinate. And thank you, Mr. Box. Okay, very exciting. But I wonder what else is coming around the next corner, guys. Come on, gulp. Let's go. Find the length of the column. Oh, that's all right. Find the length of the column EF in metres, correct, to the nearest metre. Well, you've just got to find the length. That's basically this thing minus this thing. But we've already got the function for it up here in terms of X, haven't we? It's all this stuff. So basically, if you just plug and chug this value of X into that monstrosity, you will get the EF height, won't you? Yeah. Oh, look at that. I've done it. So now, what have I said here? F2. Now, F2 was the straight line, the way I plug these things into my calculator. The railway line, straight line thingy. So that's the upper one. The upper one with the X coordinate plugged in, minus the lower one with the X coordinate plugged in, and I've got this. Now, what are we doing this to? To the nearest metre. Oh, that's tricky. Tricky, because remember, at the start of the question, all this stuff was in kilometres, right? So we've got 0.336009 kilometres, and we need it to the nearest metre. So you've got to multiply this answer by 1,000, and you get 336.009, or 336 metres to the nearest metre. Oh, you've got to be on the ball with this stuff, don't you? So 336, which I might say is very, very, very long. My goodness, I hope he's got some good foundations to his vertical columns. But fear not, that's his problem. And all the poor travellers. All right, come on, we better keep going. I fear there's something else happening here. Tasmania's train travels down the railway line from A to B. Well, we figured that. The speed in kilometres per hour of the train as it moves down the railway line is described by the function... goes from 0 to 4, where it's this thing. Okay, k root x minus mx squared. Well, who knows what that looks like? We probably don't need to know. Let's keep going. Where x is the coordinate of a point on the front of the train as it moves down the railway line. All right. And k and m are positive real constants. All right. Good. I think I've got all that. The train journey begins at the top of the mountain. We know that. Well, we assume that. It increases its speed as it travels down the railway line. Thrills and spills. The train then slows to a stop at B, 4-0. That is the velocity at X is 4-0. Well, I think I've got all that, don't you? All right, find K in terms of M. All right, well, K in terms of M. Well, you see, this is the equation here for the velocity, guys. Now, they're giving us one clue here. They're saying that when X is 4, the velocity is naught. So if you plugged 4 into there and you put naught over here, you'd have an equation involving K and M, wouldn't you? I think that's important to think about that before you go rushing into CAS headlong, not really knowing what the significance of what you're doing is. I always believe that because I think you can get thoroughly confused and flummoxed by CAS if you just use it willy-nilly without really, really thinking about what you're doing first, you know? Now, that means if you've got an equation in terms of K and M, you can express one in terms of the other, and they're asking us to find K in terms of M. All right, well, armed with that knowledge, I've just put these things into the CAS. So I've said K root X minus M X squared. I've put that as F3 of X, yeah? And I've got the Roger Dodger over here. Now, then I just say solve for this function equals to 0, and I'm solving it for K. All right, I'm solving it for K. Now, it's just a question of whether that was best to do on CAS or manually, but it's pretty easy both ways. And it comes out, if you do it on CAS, K equals 8 times M. All right? That's pretty good, isn't it? Okay, now, what are they going to do now? Yes, hence K equals 8M. Mr. Box, thank you. Now, next, find the value of X for which the speed V is a maximum. Okay, now, this is where it starts to get a bit murky if you just start rushing into CAS headlong without really knowing what you're doing. I'll show you both ways, CASI and manual, and I actually prefer manual if it's quite simple. I go for the CAS if it's, you know, complicated and just expeditious to use the CAS, but I just don't use CAS for its own sake. You know, I'm fairly judicious about choosing which way to go, okay? Now, this is a two-mark question, so we've got to put some working down. Now, so we want dv dx equals 0. Yeah, now, here's the CAS way of doing it. So you solve for the derivative of this speed function equals 0 for x. But I've got the given that k equals 8 times m. Now, you just get this. You just spits out this answer. X is 2 to the 2/3, or m equals 0. Well, presumably that is not the case. Because they're positive constants, they told us that, and that's not positive. So x is going to be 2 to the 2/3. Now, all right, that's the answer, but it doesn't really tell you exactly what's going on here in the way that I'll show you in a moment. Now, what have I written there? Yeah, you must set k equal to 8m, apparently, from bitter experiences. I did this. Otherwise, you get a very big mess for the answer, and that's just what you don't want in an exam setting, yeah? You do not. So hence x equals 2 to the 2/3, yeah? Thank you, Mr. Box. Or, now here's the manual. This is what I actually prefer. As I said, I'm pretty judicious the way I choose the CAS, and I don't like missing out on the sort of the thread of what's going on with these things just by using CAS and missing out on the procedural steps of what you're doing, if you know what I mean. Now, so dv dx, okay, now what I did here is I just said, all right, look, dv dx, I worked it out manually. And it's really easy to do manually, it's not complicated. It's k over 2 root x minus 2mx, and of course that equals 0 if we're trying to find the max, okay? The x-coordinate for which v is a max, yeah? The derivative will be 0. Now that's very easy. If you multiply both sides by 2 root x, you will get that k minus 4m times x to the 1/2 gets you 0. Now, let's just take that a step further and isolate the x term. X to the 3/2 equals k over m times 1/4, if you like. Now, that's very interesting because the ratio of k to m is in there, all right? Is in there. And we just found out that k was 8m before. So therefore, that means that that's going to be 8 over 4 or 2. So therefore, x is going to be 2 to the 2/3 if you raise both sides of that equation to the 2 over 3 just to solve for x. So, and it's pretty obvious that the ratio of k over m features in this result, right? If k over m is 8, then you'll get a 2 to the 2/3. If k over m is something else, you'll get something else to the 2/3. But that's what I sort of get the coherence of what's going on here if I do this manually, and I don't get any idea of it if I do it on just straight on the CAS. That's what I'm trying to say, so just be careful. Now, next step. Tasmania is able to change the value of M on any particular day. Well, he's very clever, isn't he? As M changes, the relationship between K and M remains the same. Ha ha! You see? So K over M stays as 8, or K is 8M. So therefore, that tells you guys, on one particular day, M is 10, find the maximum speed of the train. Correct to one decimal place. Now, all right, you see, we know that as long as K over M equals 8, then X is always going to be 2 to the 2 thirds at the maximum speed, because we found that up here. But it's not terribly obvious from just this straight CASI gobbledygook stuff here. So I'm confident that I know what I'm doing now. I know X is going to be 2 to the 2 thirds, because they've just told us that the relationship between K and M is preserved. Now, if M equals 10, find the maximum speed of the train. Well, that's all right, no problem. We know that X is going to be 2 to the 2 thirds. We plug it into the speed thingy with M equals 10. Yeah, that's what we do. So hence, yes, we need X where dv dx equals naught, M is 10 and K is 8M. That just summarises everything that we need. And then we sub X, the X value, to get V max. Now, there's the CAS version. I'm saying that K equals 8M, Roger Dodger. Then I'm saying solve for the derivative of the speed equals 0 for X, and we get this again. Now, then we say, okay, the speed with 2 to the 2 thirds plugged in, given that M equals 10, and you get this, 75.5953. What are we supposed to do? Correct to one decimal place. So I'd say it's 75.6 kilometres per hour, okay? Thank you, Mr. Box. That's that one. Now, here's the manual way of doing it. From the above manual calculation, which I did up there, this one up here, okay, I can say if K over M is constant at 8, which is what I was going on about before, therefore dv dx equals naught when X equals 2 to the 2 thirds. Yes, it's going to be X is 2 to the 2 thirds if K over M equals 8. Therefore, we can say, therefore, V max is V at X is 2 to the 2 thirds, M is 10 and K is 8, times 10, which is 80, etc., etc. Plug it into the equation for the speed and Bob's your uncle. Yeah, you're getting it? Yeah, see, it's clear. But because we did this up here manually, I maintain it's a bit clearer, you know? Okay, I think we're thoroughly sick of him by now, aren't we? It must be nearly over. If on another day the maximum value of V is 120, find the value of M. Okay, this time they're telling us the V, we've got to find the M, but we know that K over M equals 8. That's got to be simple to do. 2-mark question, not too hard. So, yes, if K equals 8M, V max occurs when X is 2 to the 2 thirds. So you just plug 120 in as V, and we've got to find the value of M, don't we? Yes, well, that's going to be easy. Solve for M when V is 120, K equals 8M, X equals 2 to the 2 thirds. Summarising like this can be very helpful, guys. You're just setting out what you've got to do. Therefore, solve for the speed function where X is 2 to the 2 thirds equals 120 for M, given that K equals 8M, or just do it manually. You know, you won't go wrong. I mean, you know, with a few more manual steps built in to make yourself confident as needs be, and you get M equals 10 times 2 to the 2 thirds, and that's going to be it, Mr. Box. I think that's all of Tasmania Jones. Ah, yes, that's the end of that one.